about an issue of domestic abuse. Talked an awful lot about these in recent years, haven't we? About the issues of affecting, you know, how you can actually tackle domestic abuse when so many women are afraid to leave their abusers and afraid to go to the police. But this was a very different case. But we are hearing more and more of these cases as more of the victims, such as this person, do come forward. And this is the case of a man, Alex Skeel. He's just 22 years old, and he suffered a catalogue of injuries at the hands of his girlfriend of a number of years, Jordan Worth. But he, like many female victims, was also too scared of his abuser to go to the police. Now, Jordan Worth, the woman who abused him, was found guilty earlier this week. She's a fine art graduate, also 22. And the abuse he subjected her boyfriend too was so bad she was jailed for 7.5 years this week. Now, Alex Skeel said he suffered 4 years of mental abuse before the relationship turned violent. He said he was stabbed with a knife, and she scalded him with boiling water, banned him from the bed, and even controlled what clothes he wore. He had open burns, he said. He feared at times that she would amputate his limbs, and he went down from 10 stones to 7 stones. Now, they met at drama college in 2012. And they lived together. But eventually, very quickly, she started trying to control him, preventing him from seeing his friends, preventing him from going on Facebook. And then the physical abuse began, as well as the mental abuse. And we've heard this story many, many times involving male abusers and female victims. But in this case, it's the other way around. But this is perhaps even more of a hidden crime than domestic abuse, where the female is the victim. Let's talk about this with Mike Buchanan, who's leader of the Justice for Men and Boys Party and joins us now. Good morning to you, Mike.
Yes, good morning.
Good
Julia.
Morning. I mean, this is a horrific case, and the details have come out in court. And of course, now that this man, and now his girlfriend, ex-girlfriend, has been jailed, he's now felt safe to speak out about it. But the story he tells is exactly the sort of stories that we hear his account of, as women who are victims of abuse talk about, in terms of the mental abuse, the control, stop doing this, stop wearing that, don't do this, don't do that, don't speak to that person, and the gradual control, and then the physical abuse, then the threats. And we all stand outside and say, but why don't you leave your abuser? And he has explained once again really clearly why he was too scared to contact the police. But is there lots more evidence that there are more and more cases, not just of women being abused by male partners, but men being abused by female partners, and them finding it even harder to go to the police than female victims?
Yes, male victims of domestic violence have a particular problem in that, you know, if the police turn up, you know, to a domestic fight, the default assumption is that the man is the perpetrator.
Yeah.
And the unusual thing about this case, the Jordan Worth case, Julia, is that the woman is in prison today.
Yeah.
And very often violent women are given suspended sentences, which is no sentence, even when they've been convicted of violent crimes previously. And we report cases most weeks on our website, and you may recall Lavinia Woodward, an Oxford University student.
Yes.
She stabbed her boyfriend, and the judge described her as being too intelligent to go to prison. Women not being sentenced adequately has long been endemic. And if men were treated as leniently as women in sentencing terms, 5 out of 6 men in British prisons today would not be there.
Yeah, that's very interesting. And again, a lot of times the argument is because in these long-term relationships where this abuse comes to light, often there are children. The view is, well, you can't take the mum away from her children. I often think those kids might benefit from being away from a mum like that. But this is the thing. The reaction, I've spoken to a number of men who've been victims of domestic abuse over the years, of course, as a journalist and hosting phone-ins on radio stations, that often they say, you know, that the 2 or 3 key issues. One is no one's going to believe me. The other is people are going to laugh at me. The other issue is, again, as you say, if there's a fight, if she's abusing him and he sort of defends himself, he calls the police. The police arrive. She says, he attacked me. As you say, the police, and many people would understand this, the police will arrest him. Often, of course, the man is bigger than the woman. No one believes, well, how can she cause any injury? But one of the key issues, and this not in this case in particular, but for a lot of these cases, is the threat to the man made by the woman that he will lose contact with his children. Cases where women claim there's been a sexual abuse or physical abuse of the children, no smoke without fire, the man loses contact, loses custody, the woman is able to control that. And often the men have said to me, they don't leave for the very similar reasons women often don't leave, is that they are afraid of losing their children.
And for men particularly, rather than women, Julia, it's a very well-justified fear. You know, and if we look at, so, you know, what options does a man have who's the victim of a domestic violence. You know, there are very few refuge places in the UK for male victims of domestic violence, and not one for men with their children. So men do stay with violent partners in part to do what they can to protect their children. And male victims of domestic violence are also denied social housing because they're not considered vulnerable. So they often end up.
They often don't get the children. It's only once because the woman's got the children, she can then get access to the housing.
Exactly. And, so these men often end up street homeless, and street homelessness removes an average of 30 years of life expectancy.
What do we do about this then? Because look, when I've debated this with women representing women's refugees, they will say the vast majority of victims of domestic violence are women. The vast majority of perpetrators are men. And that this has been something that is not a major issue that needs to be tackled. What would you say to that?
They're liars, Julia. I mean, pure and simple. I mean, it's been known for decades that most, partner violence is reciprocal. So at different times, the men and the women will be the perpetrators and the victims. But it's also long been known that in couples where the violence is one way, the perpetrator is twice as likely to be the woman than the man. Twice as likely. The whole domestic violence industry is run by radical feminists who have been lying through their teeth for decades, and they get away with it all the time.
Well, no, but there's no doubt at all. There is domestic violence. I've spoken to the victims. I've spoken to the family members. I've spoken to the men who perpetrated that violence. But again, I've also spoken to men who themselves have been victims. Do you think we need to take the biological sex, the gender out of this? We need to just make this a victim perpetrator thing, and that we all, whether it's the refugees, whether it's the police, social service, the local councils, we need to just simply see, as we would with any other crime, burglary, a murder or whatever, this is not about gender. This is not, I mean, whenever people talk about domestic violence as a violent crime against women, I always say, no, it's a crime, full stop. It's a crime of violence. It's irrelevant who it happens to. If it happens in your own home, it's a terrible, terrible crime. But do we need to take the gender issue out of this and just see it for the crime that it is?
I think absolutely. You know, it is domestic violence. It's been known for certainly 40 years. It's not a gendered problem. It's a generational problem. Children who grow up in households with parents who are violent, will themselves, they learn to be violent, yeah. And so it perpetrates generation after generation. And in the meantime, the domestic violence industry, which is, as I say, is controlled by radical feminists, is never exposed, for the lying. For all the lies that they tell, it never ceases to amaze me how the extent of male victims of domestic violence just doesn't make it into the papers. It's always regarded as a very unusual thing.
Yeah, and you're saying the evidence is it really isn't, and I know certainly some surveys have shown that isn't the case. Okay, so how do we make it easier for male victims as well as female to come forward? There's been a lot of work trying to make it easier for female victims to come forward, because one of the issues we know is that the point at which you seek help, the point at which you go to a refuge, where you go to the police, is actually the point where you are most at risk of being killed or severely beaten by your partner. That's what obviously lots of women, people say, why do you stay with someone who threatens you? Because that's how you stay alive. Two women a week are killed by their partners or immediate ex-partner. So what do we do to encourage men to come forward to talk about this?
Well, I think there's a need for a huge public information program here, Julia. I mean, women recognise when they're victims of domestic violence. You know, there's been so much in the media
I still think there are a lot of women who don't, to be honest with you.
But I think they're outnumbered by the men who are victims and think, oh, Mary's upset again. They don't see them, they have to stop Mary getting upset, rather than Mary has to stop hitting them with a baseball bat.
Yeah, and also, I suppose, if a guy gets hit, that the sort of reaction will always be, oh, what did you do wrong? Something I've noticed, definitely, when you see in films, in soap operas and dramas generally, and actually, not often, even in comedies, even rom-coms, where the guy has done something wrong, whether it's sleeping with another woman or something like that, and the woman will hit him, batter him, completely physically out of control. And that is, the way it is filmed and the way it's seen and viewed in the film, appears to be that is an acceptable acceptable and reasonable response from a woman who has been wronged. If you saw it the other way round and a man walked in and saw a woman maybe with another partner and he battered the woman, we would all immediately go, that's awful. He's a horrific. He's an abuser. Do we just see violence by women in a different way?
We do indeed. You're absolutely right. So I was in a documentary recently with Karen Brady and disagreeing with her over the gender pay gap. And some woman left on social media said that man needs a smack in the face.
Yeah,
you know, yes. we have in July in London, we're hosting the fourth international conference on men's issues, and there's a man there called Ian McNichol who was the victim of extreme domestic violence, and he was lucky to escape with his life. His partner attacked him with a hammer. He woke up in hospital. Just horrendous. I mean, I've seen him give his presentation before with the Mankind Initiative, which is a charity helping men who are victims of domestic violence. And people in the audience were in tears at his story. But you know, he's just a very noble man. You know, he doesn't hate women as a result of his experiences. And I think it'll go down a storm at the conference.
Well, indeed. I just think we should be speaking out for all victims, whatever their background, whatever their gender, sexuality. If you're a victim of domestic violence, you're a victim of domestic violence. And I think we should concentrate on that. Mike Buchanan, I really appreciate you talking to us. He's the leader of the Justice for Men and Boys Party. Talking about that after this man, Alex Skill, has spoken out for the first time about the catalogue of injuries he suffered at the hands of his girlfriend, Jordan Worth. She's 22-year-old as well. She's a fine art graduate. She's just been jailed for 7.5 years this week after 4 years of mental and physical abuse of her partner, including stabbing him, scalding him with boiling water and controlling everything he did, everything he wore, and even who he spoke to in his family. Absolutely extraordinary case. Thank you very much to Mike Buchanan. Coming up, we'll get an update.